So in this video, we're going to discuss statically indeterminate structures. So imagine I had a truss structure like the one I've drawn here, something we've analyzed a number of times and something we know how to go in and calculate the forces in each of the members of this truss. Now imagine I come along and I modify this truss by adding some new elements that I'm sketching in red here. The question is then, how do we compute the forces in the members of this truss? So, it might not seem obvious at first because, well, before I added these red elements, the truss was standing there on its own. We could calculate the forces. They were sufficient to hold the load up. And if you imagine I came and I constructed these elements out of rubber bands, well, it probably wouldn't really do much to the rest of the structure, especially if the members that I've sketched in black are made out of steel. However, if I came and put steel bars in here, it seems like something ought to happen. But there's no way that we can calculate the loads in these members from what I've sort of taught you already. And so what this is pointing at is something we call statically indeterminate structures, which simply means that static equilibrium or statics alone is not enough to determine the forces in the members. So we have to consider deformation. And so that'll be the topic of this video. Okay, so now let's look at our first statically indeterminate structure. So in this case, I'm just gonna have a simple plate held up by three springs and pulled on with a load P. Now these two springs labeled A are going to be the same, and this spring is going to be different, so they're going to have different stiffnesses. So let's start by considering statics, or the free body diagram. So the free body diagram of the plate would be pretty simple. I have my load P here, and then I have three forces pulling upwards. Okay, if I sum the moments about this point, right here, it's going to tell me that those two forces are the same. So the forces exerted by spring A are going to be the same. So I'm going to have FA pulling up here. And I'm also going to have FB pulling up here. So I'm going to have really just two forces, FA and FB. So statics would also tell me that the sum of the forces in the y direction equals to zero, which would lead me to the conclusion that FA, two times over, plus FB is equal to my known load P. So this is what statics tells us. So statics tells us there's a relationship between A and B, but it doesn't tell us what FA and FB are. So we have to consider deformation. In this case, this is just a simple spring, and you may have seen something that we've called Hooke's law, which we'll talk about more in coming lectures, but for a spring, the way it's usually written is that the force is proportional to displacement. So in this case, we would say that FA is proportional by some constant for its spring A times delta A, where delta is just the change in the length of the spring. So if we imagine when I apply the load, initially, before I apply the load, we're in this configuration, I applied my load P, these three strings stretch down and comes to a new configuration. That would be the displacement. And if I have two linear springs, this is going to be nothing more. Than two spring laws for springs A and B. So they're going to follow the same form, but if our springs are different stiffnesses, this spring constant, or this number that we can measure, or maybe it's listed on the package when we buy the spring from the catalog, which it actually is when you buy springs, they can be different values. So one can be stiffer than the other. So we have two relationships, statics and deformation. The last relationship we need is something we'll call compatibility. And compatibility in this case means that if this plate moves down uniformly because these two forces at the ends are the same, then the displacement of spring A equals the displacement of spring B is equal to displacement. So the thing just moves down. So these two displacements of these two springs are not independent, but they have to be the same. So that's what we call compatibility. And now we can put all this together. We have enough information now to solve the problem. So I just take my spring laws, put them into my statics law, I get a relationship that looks like that. So now I can factor this thing, and I can come to a relationship for delta, which is equal to P over twice KA plus KB. And this now allows me to solve for this force in spring A. So I just simply take this relationship, plug it back into my spring law, and I get the relationship that I'm looking for. So I get a relationship that FA is some fraction of my known load P. Now there's two useful limits to think about. One is that KA is much, much greater than KB. So A is a much, much stiffer spring than B. So this one is made of steel, and this is just a flimsy rubber band. In that case, I've got a big number, and a tiny number. So imagine KA is 100. I have 100 over 200, and imagine KB is 1. So 100 over 201. So in this limit, FA is going to approach P over 2. So it's as though spring B doesn't even exist. It's not even there. The other limit, well, the other limit would be that this spring takes all the load and it's like those aren't even there. So in that limit, FA ought to go to 0. And we see that it does, right? Because if KA is 1, we have 1 over 2 plus, and now KB is 100, so over a tiny number. I mean, so it's a tiny number, so we have a small number over a big number. So in this case, FA is driven towards 0. So those would be the two limits. So statics alone tells us that the force in A can't be anything. It has to be between 0 and P over 2, but it has freedom to kind of roam between there depending on the relative stiffness of these two springs. So statically indeterminate structures have to use statics, deformation, and geometric compatibility. So now to assume a more complicated example, let's look at the following structure. So I have a corner rigid wall. I have three springs, A, B, and C. I'm going to pull on them at their node or their intersection here with some arbitrary load that has an X and a Y component, but I'm going to kind of pull it downward this way, any way I want. So let's start by looking at the free body diagram, or what statics tells us. So I'm going to draw a free body diagram of the node, so this point here. So we have the known load Px, Py pulling down. And each of these three springs is going to resist the motion along their axis, along their line of action. So A is going to pull that way, B is going to pull that way, and C is going to pull that way. And in this case, we're just going to make this a 45 degree triangle. So all our sines and cosines work out to be a nice factor of root 2. So let's look at what these equations tell us. So I have sum of the forces in x equals 0, and the sum of the forces in y is equal to 0. So I have two expressions here. So sum of the forces of x equals 0 tells my force at the right, Px, equals my forces to the left. So the x component of B, which since it's a 45 degree triangle, is just FB divided by root 2 plus FC. Py, my downward force, has to equal my upward forces, so FA plus FB over root 2. Okay, so I have two equations, but I have three unknowns, A, B, and C. So again, that's the hallmark of a statically indeterminate system. I don't have enough information from statics alone to find what the forces in A, B, and C are. Now, if I removed one of the springs, like say this one, then the problem would be solvable. Before we proceed, though, I'm going to assume that you've seen vector matrix notation. So I'm going to write this system of equations in matrix vector form. If you haven't seen matrix vector notation, then the rest of this lecture might be confusing. But I think you'll get the idea if you watch it anyway. So I'm going to write that my known loads, P, which I'll write out as the two components, Px and Py, is equal to this matrix, which I'm going to write as 0, 1 over root 2, 1, 1, 1 over root 2, 0, times my vector of forces, FA, FB, and FC. And for compactness, the way that we can write this, or P vector, so I'll use one line to denote a vector, equals A matrix. So I'm going to call this matrix here A times my vector of forces F, so one line being forces. So my known loads are proportional to my forces by this matrix here, which is encoding something about the geometry, right? Because each element in this matrix is either a sine or a cosine of sort of the angles of the geometry of this node. So this is what statics tells us. And again, it's not determinate because I can't solve a matrix system of equations if I don't have a square matrix here. So we have to go on and consider deformation. So the deformation is quite simple because each of these are just springs. So all I'm going to have is that the force in the spring is proportional to their displacement. So if a force in A is proportional to the displacement of A, force in B proportional to displacement of B, and the force of C is proportional to the displacement of C. Now it seems a little bit weird, but I'm going to go ahead and write this also in matrix vector notation because, again, in a little bit it will be useful. So I'm going to have my vector of forces FA, FB, and FC is equal to now this diagonal matrix KA, 0, 0, KB, 0, 0, 0, KC, so from statics, we had two equations and three unknowns. Now I've introduced a bunch more equations, but by introducing the deltas, I've now introduced three more unknowns. So now I have a lot of unknowns here. A, B, and C forces, A, B, and C displacements. So I quite haven't solved the problem yet. Now in vector notation, I'll write this as F vector equals K matrix. So again, the two lines underneath to remind us that it's a matrix times a vector of displacements. So now I have two matrix equations, one from statics and one for deformation. So now we have to finally consider compatibility, which in this case is a little bit more complicated, but as we'll see, it is quite workable. This is my geometry. I've drawn it as straight lines just for simplicity, but I have my three springs A, B, and C. Initially, they're at this point here. Now when I apply my load and pull, I move this point over a little bit this way and a little bit that way. And so now let's imagine that my node moves out there. So now, since these points are anchored at the wall, my new geometry is going to look simply something like this. And so now the point is moved there. So it moved over some distance x, and down some distance that I'll call y. And now we can see that when I move this point here, each of those strings, when I move this point down here, each of those springs stretches, but they have to be related to each other because the point only moves to one location. So let's look at one of these like A, and let's ask the question, what's its new length as a function of its original length? Well, the new distance from here to here is nothing more than Pythagorean's theorem, right? So it's going to be the square root of this distance, which is L, plus my displacement y squared, plus the distance I moved over this way, x squared. Likewise, C is going to be quite similar. And that should be LA, sorry. Which is, it's this distance here, which is LC plus x squared plus y squared. Okay, so before we go further with B, let's work out what this is, because now we've got something quite complicated, because we've got squares and square roots. So it's going to make what we call a nonlinear system of equations, which we could actually solve if we wanted to. But let's sort of simplify things. And let's assume that x and y are small. So this is an assumption that need not be true, right? If I made this out of rubber bands, I could move this point quite a bit. But usually we're going to be talking about structures like bridges where the displacements or the deformations are quite small relative to the lengths. So if x and y are small, we can simplify or linearize these equations using my favorite tool, which is called the Taylor series. So let's just focus on A because they're going to be very similar expressions. So the new length LA, which I'm denoting with a check, is going to equal the square root. Let's expand this thing out. So it's going to be LA squared plus 2y times LA plus y squared plus x squared. Now, if you haven't seen this trick, if x and y are small numbers, it turns out that when you square a small number, it's even tinier. And so if x and y are small, we can actually neglect these terms because they're not going to actually contribute much to the final answer. So we can approximate LA, the new length, with this expression here by ignoring these quadratic terms. And further, we can use the Taylor series expansion for the square root, and we can also simplify this expression even further. And if we simplify this expression, I can rewrite it first as LA squared 1 plus 2y over LA. So again, if y over LA is a small number, then we can approximate this thing as being nothing more than LA times 1 plus y over LA. So when I do the Taylor series expansion, the 1 half power and the square root cancels this 2 here, so I get a simple expression, or I can write this as LA plus y. And so all that's saying is if these points move just a little bit, the new length of this spring is just given by the original length plus the vertical displacement. So if I believe my expression for LA, I can just simply write LC as being the same thing, except plus x. Now, I'm not working out the details of my Taylor expansion here, so if you don't remember how to do this, I suggest you look it up and try it yourself and convince yourself that this is true. Another way you can convince yourself to true is you can just try this formula, this approximation here, on a calculator using small numbers, and you'll find it's actually quite good. Okay, so we've worked out the displacements for A and C. Now let's work it out for B. So the new length, again, the check mark above it's going to be the new length. LB is equal to this distance plus Y, this distance plus X, where again, X and Y are just the displacement of the node from its original point. So the only thing we have to be careful with is that this distance here is not LB, but LB times the sines of the angle. So what that means, since this is a 45 degree triangle, this distance here is going to be LB over root 2. This distance here is also LB over root 2. So we have LB over root 2 plus x. So that's that distance, plus LB over root 2 plus y, which is that distance. So now I've got a lot of squares and square roots, so again, let's expand things out and linearize it. So we get an expression like that once I write all the terms out. Now we can kind of start to group things together. And again, this is a little bit tedious, so it's probably the kind of thing you should try yourself. And again, I'm going to start my linearization process by ignoring these quadratic terms in my small distance x and y. So now I've factored out the LB. Now again, using the Taylor series, I can kind of crank through this. Now I'll skip a few steps here and just write this out as the final result. So it's going to be LB plus x over root 2 plus y over root 2. Now if we had a different angle here, this would turn out to be sines and cosines of the angle, but you kind of get the point now. So this is great. So now we have an expression for the new links LB, and on the previous page, LA and LC. So let's summarize our results. So those are our three new links, LA, B, and C. Now, the displacement delta is just the new length minus the original length. So if I write this out as delta A, B, and C, you just see that the lengths cancel. So I can write this out in our matrix form if I'd like. So it'd be delta A, B, and C. So my vector of deltas is going to equal this matrix 0, 1, 1 over root 2, plus 1 over root 2, 1, 0, times my vector of displacements of the node x and y. Now if we're careful and we go back and we look at our previous page, we'll note that we can write this as a vector delta equals a matrix A, but written on its side, so transpose. So this is the same matrix that we had from statics, times my vector of forces. So let's summarize. So we have three expressions. We have that my vector of known loads P is related to the forces in my members F. So this was our relationship from statics. We have the forces being proportional to displacements through my diagonal stiffness matrix K, which is the stiffness of the springs. So this is a relationship given by deformation. And then finally, we have the displacements are related to the deformation of each spring is related to the displacements of the load. And so this is our compatibility. And it will always turn out, as in this example, for even more complicated examples, that when we linearize the compatibility equation, that this matrix that we get from statics is the same matrix we get here, only it's transpose. Now, we can put all this together by simply substituting in, and this is effectively what we did in the first example with the horizontal plate with the springs. So I would say that F, I would substitute this relationship into here, is equal to matrix K times matrix A transpose times our displacements X. If I multiply this expression by the matrix A, AF is nothing more than my known loads P. So I get a final expression that looks like this. So these matrices are all known. Now they're not all square, but the result is when I multiply them all together, I get a 2x2 matrix. So if we remember, this matrix A was 2 rows by 3 columns, K was 3 rows by 3 columns, and A transposed is 3 rows by 2 columns. And so when I put all those together, I end up getting a 2x2 matrix. So P, my known loads is P, so I have PX and PY, and I have my vector X and Y. So again, this is PX and PY multiplied by a 2x2 matrix, the elements of which I have to compute by this operation, equaling X and Y. Now, I typically know this and I want to solve for this, so I'd have to take this matrix and compute its inverse so I could find X and Y given the known loads P, and then I could simply back calculate. So at this point, this is where we would typically want to put these types of equations into a computer just to make it easier to solve it numerically. And what's interesting is even if we had an arbitrarily complex structure, the same type of algorithm would work. It would just be that these matrices would get larger and larger and larger. So this is our first example of a kind of complicated statically indeterminate structure. I know this is quite a bit of detail, but hopefully you kind of see the algorithm that one would go through to compute the forces in all the members of a complex truss structure, even in the case where it's statically indeterminate. So in a statically indeterminate case, we always have to consider not only the statics, but the deformation and the compatibility condition.